So that the topic I was asked, and I said I should, since this is a space application center, I kept wondering, how do you apply space? And I kept asking, how does that mean? And I got a very nice understanding of the history of this wonderful institute. So I think it is important, since most of you all are scientists, the word mythology is an interesting one. And I think we should invest some time in understanding this word. Because when you understand this word, you understand so many things. You understand history, you understand language, you understand psychology, you understand politics. This one word explains everything. So the word mythology did not exist 200 years ago. Nobody used this word. This word didn't exist. So when did this word come into existence? It comes into existence in European universities in the 19th century by scholars who are called Orientalists. These are scholars of Europe who are trying to make sense of the world that they are exposed to. So Africa, America, they've conquered Africa, they've conquered America, they've conquered Asia. They're going to establish their empires in these places. They're trying to understand these places. And they realize people in different parts of the world think very differently from them. And therefore they conclude that all other methods of thinking are absurd and their method of thinking is refined. So everybody else is wrong and they are right. Now this is a very psychological thing whereby you position yourself in a position of power. And they said that whatever we say is real and whatever other people say is false. And they use the word myth as falsehood. Right? So that's the definition they gave in the 19th century. The word myth has its origin in a Greek word called mythos. Mythos means a story. And the Greek philosophers used the word logos or rationality as the opposite of mythos. So the original meaning was story-based philosophy versus logic-based philosophy. That's all. They didn't use it as true or false. They didn't use these words at all. They only said a philosophy based on storytelling is mythos. And a philosophy which is based on logic is logos. The world of Socrates, Aristotle, Plato, all this entire world of philosophers, they never used words like true and false. They just simply said, that is not based on logos, that's based on mythos. Mythos, logos. So if you read Plato, he will define mythos as shadows in the cave. Imagine you're locked in a cave and you have spent your entire life watching shadows in a cave. That is mythos. But if you were to logically use your mind and you escape the cave, you'll one day realize that outside the cave there is sunlight. And that is logos. So that's the way he divided the world. But the European Orientalists did not divide the world in this way. They said story-based philosophy is false. And by logos, they were now being introduced to the idea of science. So they didn't necessarily mean by logos logic. Logic and science are very different things. Science is based on measurement. It's all about measurement. Measurement, 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 measurement. And therefore evidence based on measurement. And they said science on one side, and whatever science says is true, and everything which is not measurable is false. But it was not that simple in the 19th century. Because in the 19th century, the early scientists came from a Christian background. So Newton, Isaac Newton, when we use the word Newton, we keep forgetting these were church-going scientists. So they belonged to two worlds. On one level, they had the Bible. On the other side, they had measuring instruments. And this created a lot of conflict in the 17th, 18th, 19th century. The early scientists had one foot in religion and one foot in the world of science and measurement. And this ruptured the worldview, because suddenly measuring instruments were telling them a very different reality from what the holy book was telling them. This is the time when suddenly you realize that the world was not built in 7 days, that the sky is not a hard base, but that you can go beyond the sky, and that the sun goes around the earth. And many, many, many information was coming, which was surprising them, that what the book was not talking about. In the 19th century, people actually believed the world began in 5000 BC. They'd mathematically, they'd calculated the information available in the Bible, and they came up with this conclusion that God created the world in 7 days in 5000 BC. And suddenly you have the same scientists who are reading this book saying, we are not quite sure that is correct. Or you have one of the most difficult times, Charles Darwin suddenly discovering fossils and coming to a conclusion about evolution. And then not knowing, because his wife was a very religious person, and the husband and wife loved each other. And there was great tension in the family whether to publish his book or not. Because the world of measurement and the world of observation and the world of logic was revealing a very different reality from what the holy book was saying. So suddenly in the 19th century, you have again this word, this binary, true and false. True is equal to logos, which is not accurate if you study it carefully. And false was equated with mythos. This structure existed in the 19th century. And people were confused where to locate the Bible, in the world of logos or the world of mythos. All institutions were controlled by kings, monarchs. Every university was controlled by the monarch who got his power from the church. The church and the state were not separated. So a scientist, if you wanted a career in science, you have to work in a university. If you have to work in a university, you're going to be paid by someone who is directly or indirectly controlled by the church and therefore the king. You have to make statements very carefully, otherwise your funding will get cut off. So suddenly you are trapped in this world where you don't know where to locate the Bible. In a library, should I put it in the fiction section or the non-fiction section? These are problems that are happening in Europe, remember. They're not happening in India and the rest of the world. They're only happening in Europe. As far as the Europeans were concerned, any knowledge which is non-European was false, was mythos. But the inner struggle in Europe was a bigger one. Where do I locate the Bible? And this battle really ended with the Second World War. It's only 50, 60 years ago. In the Second World War, all empires came to an end. Before the Second World War, the world was controlled by kings. And the kings got their power from the church. The British Empire was the largest empire. Queen and kings of England got their power from the church. They could not openly oppose the church. This was the structure. So in 1920s, 1930s, if you were there, remember how the position, how these universities were designed. You couldn't openly talk against the holy book. But after 1950s, everything changed, because now a new world order had come to being. We did not believe in empires. We did not believe in kings and colonies. We now had a world of democracy and nation states. And it is the people who give power to the state. So there is no church, there is no king, there is no importance given to God. Scientists can now speak openly. And the world of atheism, rationality starts to rise. And people start openly saying this book is... They started using the word, the Bible is fiction. And that created a lot of tension. Even today, if you go to the USA, there's a huge divide between the evolution lobby, which is supported by the scientific team, and the creation lobby, which is controlled by the church. So in America, you can't teach evolution. You have to teach evolution and creation. You have to talk about something called intelligent design. All these concepts exist because USA is not a secular state. The president of America raises his hands in the name of God, an entity which cannot be measured and therefore has no scientific validity. India, you don't do that. So India is a secular country. India is a country where the prime minister owes his power to the people of the republic, not to God. Very different. We should always remind ourselves of this. And that is the great tradition we created our country in. And so when you understand this, why is it important to understand this? Is that this tension between truth and falsehood is a complex one. And everybody has been using this. When I use the word mythology, people keep saying, "Toh tum kya bol rahe ho? Hamara dharm jhoota hai?" And I smile because obviously they have not read enough. And I know where they're coming from. They're coming from very 19th century understanding of binaries, of truth and falsehood. And a struggle which took place really in Europe, it has nothing to do with India. This binary division, true and false, is not the way Indian tradition ever looked at the world. If you read the scriptures, when you read the Vedas and the Puranas, the division of the world is very, very different. They don't divide the world as such or jhoot, right and wrong, true and false. This binary doesn't exist. So I'll give you a simple example. You read the Bhagavad Gita and you will suddenly have this description of Krishna saying, the whole world is me. I'm the world. And the huge descriptions, it's called a Virata Swarup. What does it mean at a philosophical level? It means everything is divine. Nothing exists outside divinity. So you cannot separate, divide the world into God and not God. Everything is God. This concept doesn't exist in every part of the world. In many parts of the world, God is separate from the world. The scientist is separate, just as you are separated from your instrument. I am not the instrument. I am observing the world. Observer, observation. The Indian thought is, the observation is the observer. There is no separation between science and the scientist. It's a very different way of looking at the world. So there is no division between sach and jhoot. The word used in Indian tradition is sat and mithya. And today in casual parlance, we use the word mithya as equal to false. Ye to mithya hai. That's not the meaning of the word. Mithya. Because why do I say this? The other word used is maya. And maya is used as the word, people use it very casually. It means delusion. Or you have the word maya being used. We forget that Krishna is called mayin, the source of maya. His shakti is called yoga maya. Or Shankaracharya uses this phrase, technically not told by him, but attributed to him. Jagat mithya brahma satyam. And people say the world is delusion and the truth is brahma. This is a wrong translation. We are trying to use language of India being explained using the language of Europe. Let me explain it in a very simple, in another way. How many of you use Apple phones? Can you raise your hands? That's it. I think you should talk to your pay commission. I'm shocked. How many use Samsung or the Android systems? Oh my God. So with my limited knowledge of technology, there are two different operating systems. There are two different operating systems. And on the operating system sit apps. So there's a WhatsApp which is based on Android, and there's a WhatsApp which is based on iOS. From a superficial point of view, both are WhatsApps. But if you go deeper, they are not the same because the operating system is different. In the same way, everybody has a religion. Europe has a religion, America has a religion, Africa has a religion, India has a religion. But operating system is different. Indian operating system is different from the European operating system. Indian operating system is based on rebirth, punarjanma. Indian operating system is based on the principle that the observer is equal to observation. You cannot separate the two. Brahma and Brahmand are one. Separation happens in fear. Jab bhay hota hai, vibhajan hota hai, khandan hota hai. The Western operating system says you live only once. There is only one life. Because after death I cannot measure. I can't measure what happens to you after death. There is only one. Even before science, they said there is only one life. Even before science, the belief was. So science is reconfirming the bias of the mythology before. The operating system says you have only once. You live only once. And God is separate from creation. Observer is not equal to observation. Very different. Two different operating systems. You cannot compare the same just because the WhatsApp looks the same. This is the way you understand mythology. Mythology is the world of operating systems, psychological operating systems. It is the subjective truth of a people. It is not objective. You cannot use the word objectivity. Objective measurement, all the principles of science cannot be actually applied to mythology. You can use the scientific process to fine tune your understanding of mythology, which I do, but in itself, mythology, essentially I'm entering the mind of a people. I'm entering the mind of a people. I'm trying to understand how do people look at the world. Dunya ko dekhne ka tarika kya hai? Drishtikon kya hai? What is the way? So, in one operating system, there's a concept of true God and false God. The true God is a jealous God, says false God shall not be worshipped. Remove. True God, false God. This is the concept of one operating system. The other operating system says there is no such thing as true and false God. There is a limited God and limitless God. Limited and limitless. Limited is mithya, limitless is satya. Limitless is called, what is limitless? Ananta, that which has no ending. Infinity. Purna, that is purna. So infinity is equal to completed. Purna. Purna midam, purnam. These are words which mean infinity. Now, as a mathematician, all the students of mathematics will understand, how can you call infinity complete? Because completion means boundary. Ananta, purna. So, myth and mithya, mithya and satya are looked differently. They don't mean true and false, not true God, false God. So, when I go to an Indian village and I see a grama devata, I'll say, ye kya, ye kaun hai? They will say, ye hamara gaon ka devata hai. Now, I have never seen this. I'll say, if I come from this operating system, I'll say, that is a false God. If I come from this operating system, I'll say, acha, ye gaon ka devata hai. Puri dunya ka devata nahi hai. Ye tumhara devata hai. Lekin pure brahmand ka devata kaun hai? So, this is a subset of a superset. Very different from invalid. There is no set to be discussed. It is invalid versus valid. Imaginary versus real. ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम इज डिफरेंट, यह समझाना बहुत मुश्किल है लोगों को. इफ यू स्टार्ट बिलीविंग देर इज ओनली वन ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम इन द वर्ल्ड, यू आर अ फूल. इफ यू बिलीव देर इज द बेस्ट ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम इन द वर्ल्ड, यू हैव नॉट अंडरस्टूड ह्यूमन बीइंग्स. दिस सिस्टम सेज एवरीथिंग इज ट्रू, बट चेक द डिनोमिनेटर. That is the difference. Is the denominator one or infinity? If it is one, it assumes it is the only thing that exists. If it is infinity, it doesn't take itself seriously. So, anant shabd, kahan se aaya? Vedon se aaya. Infinity. At that time, it is perhaps, we are not sure whether they meant it mathematically or conceptually. Depends on who you talk to. Somebody will say, no, ancient India, everything happened. Okay, fine. Your truth. Some will say, oh, conceptually they had understood infinity. Ki what I know is not the limit of knowledge. There is no limit to knowledge. It keeps expanding. How far will it go? To infinity, ananta. And these are the ideas that emerge from Indian thought. So when you talk about Indian thought, one has to understand the concept of denominator. This operating system, denominator is only one. Anything else is invalid. Only one truth can exist. Science as we know it today emerged in Europe within this operating system. We are now learning science as taught in this operating system. There is another operating system which looks at science very differently, but we have not explored it adequately, which says every knowledge is valid. But database dekho na, bahut kam database hai isme. Isme bahut ek database hai. It's a very different approach. How do you explain this? Because they're all told through stories. So when I was studying medicine, I'm trained in medicine. I'm from Grand Medical College. I'm one of those, you know, get those bright, always standing first in class kind of person. You are trained. Medicine mein jaoge, engineering mein jaoge. Nothing else. That is what you're supposed to do. So middle class family, parents migrated from Odisha, come to Bombay. Father goes under advice to learn, he studies MBA in America, comes back to India before IIMs were established in India, applies for a job. For 6 months he doesn't get employment because everybody says, yeah, MBA kya hai? So in 1960 my father was unemployed for a period of 6 months because he had an MBA degree from New York. You can imagine what it does to a man. I was never told about MBA. Padne ka nahi. Doctor banne ka, doctor. And you are studying medicine, and when you are studying medicine, obviously you are a good student, you do it well, seat in surgery waiting for you, and you are like, doesn't work for me, I am not happy, it's horrible. Getting high marks doesn't necessarily mean you are happy. And your mother is saying, you know, in Odia, if you hear the pune hobo, you will be a pune. You know, the greatest fear of a middle class family. You will not get a job. So she said, give an IAS exam. So I gave IAS exam and I got through, unfortunately. And I went for the interview in Delhi. And I don't know how many of you all know this great divide between Bombay and Delhi. We hate each other. Very simple. I am raised in Bombay. I live in a very, very different operating system. And I go to that weird operating system in Delhi. I'm like, this, I'm not spending my life here. I said, whatever it is, I'm going back to Bombay. So anyway, IAS was not happening and you're completely confused with your life. The only good thing you're good is you're good in communication. And therefore you become a medical communicator. You join the pharmaceutical industry as someone who writes those documents for the medical department, for the sales force, all the documents. And Circumstances take me into becoming what is called a medical expert in medical communication. I make a lot of money independently. I'm not working for anyone. My father doesn't understand what I'm doing. He thinks I'm unemployed and he's terrified. I'm really earning more money than him. I'm telling him, look, 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 the checks are coming. He says, yeah, but do you have a job? I'm sure he thought I was selling drugs. So, and it's a classical middle class anxiety because you can't think outside the box. You're refusing to think outside the box and you hate your son for thinking outside the box. Luckily, circumstances worked in my favor. I managed to get a job with the weirdest title because I met equally crazy people in the corporate world who were thinking it was the time of the dot-coms. It was the time of technology first time coming in, the early 2000, it's 2000 really, around 2000. I'm already 30 years old and the world is changing. Suddenly this IT thing is coming. This something called IT is coming and everybody wants to be part of e something. E-commerce and e-thing and everybody wants dot-com and the dot-com boom starts. Today I'm hearing that these technologies existed 30, 40 years before that. People were thinking in terms of digital, satellites. This was there. Not that something new, but for us at that time. And I joined a pharmaceutical company and I worked in the pharmaceutical company in various capacities for 14 years. And in my pharmaceutical stint, I never really worked on medicine at all. I understood science very well. I loved science, but at an intellectual level, not at a day-to-day level to earn a living. I didn't want to sit in a clinic and look at people's throats and sick people all day. No, sorry. So I'm not meant for a doctor. It was not there in me. But I enjoyed business a lot. I enjoyed business because in the pharmaceutical industry, you're working with doctors and hospitals and logistics and production. It was fish to water. I just enjoyed business. I loved the balance sheet. I loved Excel sheets. I loved it. I mean, I can't explain how joyful it was to see an Excel sheet. Do you get that satisfaction? Something very nice about it. Everything is under control. Excel sheet is all about control, nothing else. So I loved it. But then you learn, the one thing you discover over time is that when I was studying management, that was for my money, not for my pleasure. My pleasure, I realized, was in mythology, in Ramayana, Mahabharata, Ved, Puran, something I would do in my free time. So weekdays, you're working in a corporate ecosystem in the pharmaceutical industry, so mixture of business and science. On the weekends, you are studying Ramayana, Mahabharata, Purans for your pleasure. Purely for pleasure. And then you suddenly start seeing relationship between the two. Begin with a vision statement, mission statement. Do you have a vision statement? You should have. You don't bother with it, I understand, but it's okay. Vision statement, mission statement, objective, goal, target. This concept followed by tasks. What to do? What are your tasks? This is modern management. It's called modern management by objective. You have to have an objective based on which you do manage. I read this. I'm reading all this. And I'm like, this sounds very similar to this operating system. Because in this operating system, there is the concept of the promised land. Ek aisi dunya jahan pe khushyali hogi, everybody will be happy. There will be no hunger. There will be no suffering. You will not be a slave. You will not be a slave. Here will be happiness. Ek dunya aisi dunya ki rachna hum karenge jahan pe khushyali hogi. Aur kaun leke jayega humko wahan pe? Masiha leke jayega. I said, oh God, this looks so familiar. The pattern. The pattern is the same. Vision, mission, objective is equal to promised land. The Paigambar who is going to take me there, the Masiha, sounds like the CEO. Wo leke jayega wahan pe mereko. And then the Paigambar has commandments. These are the commandments, rules that you shall not break. We call them standard operating procedures. And what is the biggest problem in the Bible? Non-compliance. And therefore, we have an audit department. this management system. Now, is it coincidence that management is aligned to the biblical systems, is applied to this operating system, because they all come from Europe and America, where everybody is raised thinking about in a particular way. Even science is taught like that, right? You have an introduction, experiment, conclusion. QED. I have demonstrated God exists. Conclusion. Not ananta, anta. True God, false God. Only one true God. There cannot be two true gods. Only one. Therefore, debate. When you do PhD, you have to defend your thesis. Nobody finds it violent. Defend. Are you defend against whom? It's just knowledge. If it is wrong, it is wrong. Can't be proven, can't be proven. Tension kyun le raha hai? Why is my ego attached to defeat? Why is it defeat? Because information is not, your hypothesis doesn't work. Tension kyun le raha hai? Because your denominator is wrong. Your database is wrong. Your assumptions are wrong. Maybe it is mithya, limited knowledge. When more knowledge happens, maybe we will find something else. Mithya, satya, another way of looking at it. This won't work. That may work. And we have to keep going towards infinity. It will never end. In my entire life, I will not solve it. Steve Jobs has gone, but the world has not stopped. All scientists will disappear, but science will keep progressing. And in your lifetime, you will never see the end of science. There is no boundary. But whatever you know is complete in itself. Purna vidam, purna. Jo pata hai, it is complete in itself. It is not false. It is complete in itself. But it is not complete in another way. Because it will keep expanding. So the new operating system, so I asked myself, can there be a method by which I can understand management using Indian traditions? Which means you have to first understand Indian tradition. Ye operating system jab tak samjhoge nahi, tum kaise, how will you create a management system based on a new operating system? First of all, you have to admit there are multiple operating systems. Wohi mushkil hai logon ko. There are different operating systems. How do you figure out these operating systems? By studying stories, symbols, and rituals. These are the three pillars of mythology. Story, symbol, and ritual. And every story has a history. Every symbol has a history. Every ritual has a history. What do I mean by that? When we say Ramayana, there is no one book called Ramayana. There is a Valmiki Ramayana, but there is no one Valmiki Ramayana. When you do research, when you go to Baroda, you will find almost 30 books all claiming to be Valmiki Ramayana, which are dated to about 2,500 years old. Which of them is correct? So you create a critical edition and you realize only 30% of the verses are common between all of them. So which is the real Valmiki Ramayana? And by the way, Valmiki Ramayana does not have the concept of Lakshman Rekha. Lakshman Rekha comes to us from Krittibasa Ramayana, written in Bengali 500 years ago. Of course, if I tell this in certain forums, I'll be lynched. Because that is the University of WhatsApp. And University of WhatsApp is the one of the most powerful universities in the world, rivaling Cambridge, Oxford today. And I know many gold medalists from the University of WhatsApp. And they have one, their motto, you know, every university has a motto. Their motto is Alpa Buddhi Mahabhayankaram. You can't argue with them because they'll just behead you or burn you alive or something like that. So, chhod do unko. For the sake of sanity and security, just shut your mouth in front of them. But for those who are interested in genuinely understanding knowledge, you have to understand the complex world of mythology. It's a very complex world because it really goes into the human mind and the human imagination. And how difficult it is. How do you know what you know is a subject you have to know. How do you know what you know? It's called epistemology. can you know things without your mind? If I remove your mind, does knowledge exist? Does knowledge exist if all human minds are removed? How do you know? How do you know? There is no, if there is no mind, how do you know knowledge exists? So there is another subject called ontology or metaphysics, which says knowledge which is independent of the mind. It's called metaphysics, not physics. Metaphysics or ontology. The correct word is ontology. These are new words. We have to learn these words. Ontological. This operating system says there is no ontology. There is only epistemology, because we can only access the world through the mind. So don't waste your time trying to think of the world which is outside the mind. This operating system says there is something outside the mind, and the human mind is struggling to find that out. Two different operating systems. They will never agree with each other. That is like saying one day Apple will agree with Android. Nahi hone wala hai. Of course, everybody, this is better, that is better, this is better, that is better, rubbish. Maybe there are other operating systems that I don't know about. US scientists would know of other operating systems. There are multiple operating systems, each one of them serving different functions, each one having strengths and weaknesses, which can, because of the nature of the beast, it can see opportunities and threat differently. And this is the world of mythology. It allows you to open your mind to very different possibilities. You have to study the history of science to understand the history of mythology. So how do I define mythology today? Mythology is, fact is everybody's truth. And usually it's based on measurement. Usually fact is based on measurement. It is not based on measurement, it's opinion. Fact is the world of everybody's truth. Fiction is based on nobody's truth. Mythology is based on somebody's truth. Vishwas ki baate hai. Mera vishwas hai, Bhagwan hai. This is the world. I believe in rebirth. You cannot understand Buddhism without understanding rebirth. You cannot understand Jainism without understanding rebirth. You cannot understand Hinduism without understanding rebirth. Punarjanma. You cannot understand Judaism, Christianity, and Islam without understanding the concept of God. These are fundamental assumptions. So the simple definition of myth is the assumption that anchors your life. What is the assumption that anchors your life? Somebody will say assumption is there is God. Assumption one. There is no God. Assumption two. There is God when I am unhappy, and there are no gods when I am happy. Assumption three. Assumption four. There is no God, there is a soul. Assumption six, there is energy. All assumptions. Because the fundamental thing about myth is that it should not be measurable. The moment it becomes measurable, it stops being myth. The moment you measure it and it enters the realm of science, it stops being myth. Myth has to be in the realm of imagination. Because imagination propels you. How do you understand it? How do the sages talk about this? They would talk about, look at the words they use. Ajiva or Sajiva. The world is divided into two things. Or in, it's better explained in Jain traditions. The Jains were very good in systematizing. Achitta and Chitta. What is Achitta? Achitta is things without consciousness. Now what do they mean by consciousness? I'll give you a simple definition. That which is hungry, jisko bhook lagta hai, that is chitta. So nothing complicated, a very simple definition. Is it hungry or not hungry? What comes first, food or hunger? What comes first? When you are hungry, things become food. So water has always existed in the planet. It is only when plants, I mean, I'm using plants in a very crude way, when plants appear, that it becomes resource. Plant was not resource, water was not always resource. Jab jeevit pashu aata hai, to wo resource ban jata hai. So chitta and achitta. So what is achitta? They use words like, they use, they are called dravyas. They use akash, space, kal, time, dharma. Now dharma in Jainism does not mean what dharma is used today. Dharma means motion. Adharma, lack of motion, and pugdala, matter. So this is the Jain saying the world without hunger has these five components: time, space, movement, staticness, stationariness, and pugdala, materials, measurable things. These are all measurable. And chitta. Chitta is hunger, bhook. That is how they describe. Now the difference is the world of achitta is the world of physics, is the world of chemistry. The world of physics and chemistry is not interested in hunger. That is not a subject that will appear in your dissertation. The moment chitta appears, you enter the world of biology. Now comes the world of biology. Hunger, bhook. We don't understand this one simple concept. Hunger. The first living creature. What is the first thing when we go to see? That planet may have life. We check for oxygen, we check for water. Because we assume all life forms will feed on oxygen and water. Why is that assumption there? Can hunger for something, can there be creatures which feed on sulfur? Hunger, bhook. Hunger is important. And the moment hunger appears, sajiva, they divide the world of botany into two parts. Again, these are words which you will find in every scripture. Charachara. Charachara. Charachara is animals and plants, zoology and botany. Plants are hungry, animals are hungry, microorganisms are hungry, prions are hungry, virons are hungry. All microcellular organisms are hungry. Suddenly, I realize all the science experiments I did in microbiology. Why do you have petri dishes? Why do you put blood in some, not blood in some? Because you are seeking, uska hunger kya hai? Uske hisab se the bacteria will reproduce. Hunger is important. Once you understand hunger, you understand another concept, food. And therefore, then the Taittiriya Upanishads will keep saying everything in the world is food. Everything is anna or annada. Either it is food or something that eats the food. Everything in the world is just that, nothing else. Anna annada, anna annada. So now you understand what those hymns are saying. They are looking at the world and saying, Mahabhuta is achitta. Mahabhut. So earth, fire, water, wind, and akash. And akash really means radiations, not space. It means radiation. That is achitta. There is no hunger there. Only when chitta comes. So jiva is important. They are obsessed with this. What is this thing which makes me hungry? And when I am hungry, I eat something. And I don't want to be eaten by something else. So predator and prey become important. We are all hungry for something. And then comes human beings. So after the Mahabhuta, then you have Charachara. And then you have human beings. Manava, creatures which have mana, mind. That all it means. Manu just means someone with a mind. What does mind do? It allows you to imagine. What does imagination do? It does something which no other creature experiences. You can create an alternate reality. So all other creatures are experiencing the world. All other creatures, they have indriyas to experience. So they have input points. Indriyas are the sense organs. The data comes in. So the senses are called indriya gochara. The way the sense organs, the way the cow feeds on grass, the sense organ feeds on stimuli. So when people tell me that there's artificial intelligence, I only ask this one question: is it hungry? if it is not hungry, and it is self hunger, it is not hunger that is induced, it is hunger. Hunger ko dhundo, then the world will change. Hunger, the chitta means only hunger, bhook. That is why when yajna you are feeding hunger, you feed fire, but fire doesn't run after food, therefore it is not alive. It is achitta. It has to run after food, that is critical. So the indriyas, the information is coming in, you are experiencing things, it creates emotions, chitta is emotions. Then you have the mind, vichara, which is making sense of these emotions, buddhi. But more powerful that is something called mana, imagination, which can create an alternate reality. So a deer gets afraid when it can see a tiger, smell a tiger, or hear a tiger. So input is equal to output. But when imagination comes in, I can imagine the tiger all the time. There is no correlation between input and output. You have created a creature where there is no correlation between input and output. You can give me all the food in the world and I'll still be hungry. So you give the child food, bowl of rice. The child will say, "Aur kuch nahi hai." Because you can imagine an alternate reality. Once you create a creature like this, it is non-predictable anymore. And that is a frightening thing. Because you cannot predict behavior. Now explain science if I can't predict. The obsession of Americans with behavioral science. I talk to behavioral scientists, they get very upset with my lectures. Because I keep saying, you are trying to find predictable human patterns. Humans will never be predictable. We hate being predictable. You make it predictable, I will immediately create another pattern to break it. How many parents have been able to control their children? Show me that fool. You have, well, you have kings trying to control their citizens. They are trying to control, no? And all the rishis of the Vedas are smiling. And they have a wonderful word they want to say, but you are not allowed to say among scientists. It begins with C. That is what happens. You have a world of people who are trying to control that which cannot be controlled. The word Brahmana means, Brah means expand. Mana is mind. That which expands the mind and takes you towards Purna, which will never end, right? It will never end. It's a never ending journey. So the Brahmanas are technology that helps you expand the mind. That's the meaning of the word. But we have not got it because we don't want to. That is scary because you realize if I go in this way, somebody else goes in that way. Everybody is imagining the world differently. How do I control? And I get scared. Fear. Wherever there is hunger, there is fear. Chitta has these two sides to it. Hunger and fear. Because what is the fear? Khana nahi milega. And second fear is, main khana ban jaunga. And what does it mean for human beings? We don't eat each other. Animals eat each other. But humans don't. But I'll translate this as a metaphor. Humans think metaphorically. Metaphor is not a scientific concept. When you understand metaphor, you enter the world of language. And that's why language is so difficult. And Vedas are full of metaphors. So you very difficult to say when they say fire, I am lighting fire. Do they mean literally fire or do they mean something else? Because metaphor ka meaning kya hai? My wife came and I thought of a bull. What does it mean? My husband came and I started eating peanuts. I mean, you see, kya iska? There is no logic to it because it's a metaphor. Now, what does peanuts mean? What a bull means? You all can discuss forever. No scientist on earth can ever solve metaphor. Because metaphor depends on common understanding. It's a complex idea. If you understand, any linguistic student over here will understand, metaphor is what makes things different. Humans are humans because we think metaphorically. Science will never enter the realm of metaphors. So, kabhi nahi jayega wahan pe. Kabhi nahi. How much ever you try, no instrument can ever capture metaphor. And therefore, artificial intelligence beyond the point, poorna tak pahunchega hi nahi. It has to measure. Metaphor is the great celebration of human beings. Ved is metaphor. Moving from the measurable to the non-measurable. Saguna to nirguna. Sakar to nirakar. That is the meaning. Brahma. That which will defy measurement. That is the whole world we have to understand. This is the world of Indian mythology. Brahmana, expanding of the mind, not Kshatriya. Kshatriya is land, I want to control, 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 control. Vaishya, transact, 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 transact. Shudra, don't want to think, just do, which is most human beings. Not the definition that we have, these are psychological states of being. Mereko tension nahi lene ka hai. Tell me what to do, I'll do. Shudra buddhi. That is what we want people to be. Dimag nahi lagane ka. Jo bola karne ka. You know, there's a very famous story, I mean it's a folk story of from the Ramayana, that when Lakshman was shot with an arrow and was about to die, Ram got very scared. He went to Hanuman and said, please find Sanjeevani. Then Jambavan ran to Ram and said, please give full instructions. Find Sanjeevani and bring it back. And Ram says, what do you mean? Isn't it obvious? He says, no. You told him, remember once you gave him a task. What task? He said, to find Sita in Lanka. He said, yes. Did he do the task correctly? He said, yes. But he said, he took some initiative. What did he do? He said, he burnt Lanka. He said, yes, I remember. He said, you got upset. Yes, I remember. What did you tell him? Dimag mat lagao. Do as I tell you to do. Don't take initiative. On that day, Hanuman said, I will be 100% compliant. I will not use... I will not use my imagination. I will not use my capability. This is what it means. Shudra buddhi means when we want people to just obey us. Vaishya means when we are continuously transaction. Mereko kya milega? What's in it for me? What's in it for me? Vaishya buddhi. Then you move to Kshatriya buddhi. Kshatra. I control Kshetra. This is my territory. Or koi aayega, toh main uska daant tod dunga. Sounds like so many people we hear about in the newspapers, right? Suddenly you can see these people in your life, right? Suddenly say, arey, bahut shudra hai. Mirror mein bahut dikhai deta hai. Bahut vanik hai, dikhai deta hai. Ki, what's in it for me? Kshetra, jab tak mera rajya hai, I am the king, I am the boss. Brahmana, the only purpose is to expand the mind. Nothing else matters. Everything else is, that's the realm of the rishi, the scientist, of the philosopher. Jnana, nothing else matters, only jnana. And knowing the purna is ananta. That's the journey that we are all on. And you all physically experience it through space. You bring the stars to the earth from infinity to finite problems. That's what you do. But while you are creating the apps from space, don't forget the operating systems of mythology. That's all I ask of you. Thank you.
There is a assumption, like what we do bad things in my current birth.
Oh.
For this, I will be punished in my coming birth.
Yes, yes.
Next birth. And for my next
yes,
birth,
yes.
I will not be remembering.
I won't be remembering. Yeah.
And so, sometime I may read something wrong, which I am not aware.
Yes.
And unknowingly I will do. So why this assumption with us?
The assumption over here, see, all cultures want to explain the inexplicable. All cultures are trying to explain. For example, why were you born with this body? Now, in science, I will be able to explain to you how this happened. I can explain your father's genetic structure is this, your mother's genetic structure is this, this is how the sperm met the ova, this is how you were born, this is what you are bringing, this is what you are. It explains how, it doesn't explain why. So every human culture is desperately trying to understand, aisa kyun hai, why I am not born 6 foot tall. Now how do you explain this? Some cultures, one operating system said, jyada mat dimag lagao, God has decided, shut up. Another group said, well, didn't have the idea of God. So they said, you know what, this is not the only life you have lived another life, and in that life you have done many things, and this has happened to you, which means whatever you do now is going to influence your future life. Two operating systems. Now which is better? Because there is no third option. You can create another option, random chance. That's very scary. Yeah, that's very scary. It's just random chance. Ki luck by chance, ye job mila tumko. That is a very scary. I want to believe I did work and I became this scientist. Nahi hai, tere karma mein likha tha. I don't want to hear it. God decided that you should do this, so I should outsource credit to him. Not happening. So three options, random chance, karma, God. Take your pick. The thing is, you don't know. Mythology comes in this realm of I don't know and I want something to comfort me. So main kitna brahman mein kitna handle kar sakta hu. So it's your child coming and asking you, papa, why are you my father? First you will check, is that a trick question? Like, is he happy that he or the father is unhappy? Because question ke piche ek adjective hota hai. Same thing happens with karma. People are now asking, so in the Buddhist tradition, they said the karma, karma, karma happened. So they said, is there good deeds or bad deeds? And good deeds lead to good reactions. So good action leads to good reaction. The problem is, how do you decide an action is good? How do you decide an action is good? So, for example, there is a story. Again, I'll tell you a children's story, and I'll try to understand this from a story, and instantly you'll understand what I'm trying to say. So once upon a time, there was a conference of the gods. All the gods decided to meet on Mount Kailas to discuss some universal matters. And all the gods came to Mount Kailas on their respective vahanas. So Surya came on his horse, Chandra came on an antelope, Yamuna came on a turtle, Ganga came on a dolphin, Brahma came on a swan, Vishnu came on a hawk called Garuda. When they arrived at Mount Kailas, all the gods walked up the mountain, and Garuda, like all the Vahanas, waited at the base of the mountain. And they all noticed that the path to the top of the mountain, there was an entrance, and at the entrance there was a gate, and on the gate there was a bird, and the bird was singing a beautiful song. And such a beautiful song that all the gods would bless the bird and go up. The last of the gods to arrive was Yamaraj, the god of death. He comes down from his buffalo, walks up the mountain, and then he notices the bird singing, but rather than smiling and blessing the bird, he frowns and shrugs his shoulders. And he's very upset. He's so upset, and he walks away in a huff. Garuda wonders what is going to happen to the bird. Maybe Yamaraj didn't like the song, and therefore he's going to kill the bird because he's the god of death. He wonders what to do. He gets very anxious and decides to save the bird. So he takes the bird in the palm of his hand and goes across seven mountains, across seven rivers to a forest where there is a tree. And on the tree, there are mango fruits. And he keeps the bird there and tells the bird, you live here, you eat here, far away from Mount Kailas, safe from the glance of Yamaraj. And then he returns back across the seven mountains, across the seven rivers, comes to Mount Kailas. And when he reaches Mount Kailas, the conference has come to an end and all the gods are leaving. So Surya comes down and goes back on his horse, Chandra on his antelope, Ganga on her dolphin, Yamuna on her turtle. Vishnu comes down with Yamraj. Yamraj looks at the gate and notices there is no bird and there's no bird song. And he smiles and he says, the account books are balanced. And nobody quite understands what it means. So Garuda says, what do you mean? He says, you know, when I came here, there was a beautiful bird singing a beautiful song. I loved it. But there's a problem. This bird is supposed to die today, but not here. It is supposed to die across the seven mountains, across the seven rivers. There is a mango tree, and under the mango tree, there is a python waiting to eat it. And the python was dying of starvation. I was wondering who will give it food. Garuda has given it food. Thank you, Garuda. Now tell me, did Garuda do a good deed or a bad deed? And from whose point of view are you telling? From the point of view of the sparrow, it is a bad deed. From the point of view of the python, it is a great deed. Every action has a reaction. In every action, somebody is fed and somebody is killed. So every action involves violence. Something is going to die and something is going to be sustained. This one is going to curse you, this one is going to bless you. This is how the operating system. That is why they will say, what is the advice of this? So the Jataka tales will say, do good deeds to get good things. What does Gita say? Kaam karte raho, phal ki chinta mat karo. Because what is predictable is the input. What is unpredictable is the output. You can't say this when you are applying for funds. Because we live in a system where we want control. Right? And that's one of the tragedies in our system is that the moment I give you an instrument, we want to use it to control. Scientists create instruments. You create various instruments to live a better life. Politicians turn every instrument into a weapon. So Brahmana ko Kshatriya se bahut bachke rehna chahiye. Vanik to sabko bech dega. Aur Shudra jab bolega, sir, so what do I do with this? And Brahmana will try to say, you can do this, you can do this. Sir, tell us clearly. Kshatriya will say, do this, sir. Basically, so that I can control you. And Vanik will say, aisa karega to mereko profit milega. This is the world we live in. They are all in the realm of the Brahmanas. But you will have to deal with Kshatriyas who will want to control and turn everything you do into a weapon. There will always be the Vanik who will say, kitna profit ho sakta isse? And how not to give the scientist? That is the patent wars, no, around the world. Patent is only coming from the Vaishya Buddhi, not from Brahmana Buddhi. Patent as a concept is there, nothing rational about it. It is just Vaishya Buddhi. Kshatriya Buddhi is har cheez ko weapon banao. Aur bichara Shudra. Because 99% of humanity is Shudra, sir, kya kare? And they're confused between these three people. That is the story of our life.
Mukti ki baat hoti hai, salvation. To mukti kis cheez se?
Okay, excellent question.
Aap mein incomplete lagta hai. Kis cheez se mukti?
To mukti concept India mein aata hai, is related to karma. And how do I get people to work? How do I get people to work? How should I motivate you to work? Now the nature has given something. Ki you will always be hungry. So that is the first motivation. Ki bhai aap salary chahiye, isliye job karna hai. The second is fear. Dar lagta hai. These are two motivations which are always there. In the Dharma Shastras, they said, when you are born on earth, you are born with certain obligations. Tumhara kuch rin hota hai. Look at the word they use. Rin. Debt. You have to repay these debts. So what are the debts? They'll say, you have to repay debt to your parents. You have to repay debt to your ancestors. Tumhare pitra rin hai. You have to repay debt to your teachers. You have to repay debt to the society at large. You have to repay debt to Bhutarena, which is to the entire universe. Because unke bina to terko khana kon dega? So Bhutarena hai, Rishi Rena hai. So you have, think of all the things. Would you exist if you did not have parents? Would you exist if you didn't have a family tree, lineage? Would you exist if you did not have a teacher? Would you exist without a larger society which took care of you? And would you exist without nature? So panchal, panchayagya. Wo kitna kab? Now that's the problem with this very nice dialogue is it is not quantifiable. So kitna rin hoga tumhari zindagi mein? So you feel burdened. Mere ko nahi karne ka ye sab. Wahan se mukti ki shuruaat hoti hai. And at a sophisticated, refined level, it means freedom from hunger and fear. So now the problem is when I say I don't want to be hungry and fear, so basically I'm saying I don't want the world of biology. I hate the world of biology. I want to go back to the world of physics. Because without hunger, there is no chitta. If there is no chitta, it is achitta. So this became a conflict. Achitta has no hunger and fear. Patthar, na? And the world of chitta is biology. So they said, no. We mean chaitanya. Expansion of consciousness to the point where I am not hungry, but I am sensitive to other people's hunger. So, hum patthar ki murti mein hamesha aankh, we make an eye to it. Uske bolte prana pratishtha kiya maina. What is the meaning of it? This is not a chitta rock. This is chaitanya purna devata. A vigraha it is called. Vigraha or archamurti in south. So that is the meaning of it. Ki maine ek achitta roop ko chaitanya dala hai. So what we are looking for is mukti then becomes not freedom from hunger and fear only. So freedom from hunger and fear is Shiva represents that. Shivji ko bolte hai, how do they represent it? Now as a scientist you will ask, how did you come to this conclusion? What is the metaphor? Ki Shiva is not hungry at all. So Shiva around his neck has a snake. Saap hota hai. What does a snake eat? Rats. Chuha khata hai. In Shiva's family, have you seen a rat? Wo Ganesh ji ke paas hota hai. Who eats a snake? Peacock. Where is the peacock located? Another son has it. So really in this family, they should be running after each other, right? See, logical question. Your child will ask his papa, wo snake ko kyun nahi kha raha hai? We'll say, chup bet. Hamare zamane mein prashna nahi poochte. But he's asking a very valid question. Why are they not eating each other? Because Kailas Parbat mein bhook nahi lagti. To mujhe bhook se mukti praapt hui. That is the meaning. Bhook se prapti, which means I'm not hungry. So there's no motivation now. So what is the purpose of life? Bad gap. So what is it? It's like patthar ki devata, those famous Bollywood dialogues. What is the use of you being a god? Mukti to tumne prapt kar li, but usse fayda kya? You are useless like a rock. Isliye shivling roop hota hai. Ki it's a rock. Uska value kya hai? So then comes the concept of Shivji ki shadi hoti hai. What is the meaning? Ki aap pahad se niche a jaiye aur kuch kaam kijiye. But salary aapko nahi chahiye because you are bhole nath, you are great. Salary patni ko dijiye. So salary se mukti. So this is where Vaishnav tradition start to appear. And Shiva Shakti. That's why in the Shiva temple there's always Shakti kept over there. And water is dripping on him so that he gets to work. It's called the Chinese drip torture. Kaam karo, kaam karo. And they're trying to say that tumko bhook nahi lagi hai, lekin dusron ko to bhook lagta hai. Aap unka darshan kijiye. So now you see the Vishnu stories, which is Vishnu Puran, where Vishnu is continuously doing avatar. Why is he doing this? Kiske bhook mitane ke liye? Because wo to chaitanya hai. Unko to bhook nahi lagti. Dusron ki bhook mitane ke liye. So for the other people's hunger, I am working. So this is mukti, step 1, step 2. कि मुझे आई हैव वेल्थ और आई हैव फूड. लेट्स टेक अ सिंपल एग्जांपल फूड. आई हैव फूड बट आई एम नॉट हंग्री. सो व्हाट डू आई डू विद दिस फूड? आई गिव इट टू द हंग्री पर्सन. सो दिस इज द जर्नी, इज हाउ द पुराणस आर डिजाइंड. सो त्याग मींस फर्स्ट स्टेप ऑफ त्याग मेरे भूख से त्याग और सेकेंड स्टेप इज मेरे प्रॉपर्टी से त्याग. So then now how it happens, I move from being a Shudra, because Shudra, even if the Shudra is dumb, one thing is there, he's hungry and frightened. That won't go away. So that is motivating him and all that, but he's confused because he's no direction. Shudra is like a child who doesn't know anything. His first motivation is to be a vanik. Bhook ke liye main kuch bhi karne ko tayar hu. After he gets food, then he gets more and more insecure, then he becomes Kshatriya. कि खाना मैं खाऊंगा और बाकी खाना अपने तिजोरी में बंद करके रखूंगा, बिकॉज नाउ आई कैन कंट्रोल एवरीबडी. आई विल नॉट गिव यू बोनस, आई विल नॉट गिव यू प्रमोशन, आई विल पुट यू इन स्पेशल प्रोजेक्ट्स. ऑल दीज वर्ड्स आर क्षत्रिय बन गया वो, बिकॉज ही इज नाउ ही इज कमिंग फ्रॉम ही इज अटैच टू हिज हंगर एंड हिज फूड. ब्राह्मण, you outgrow that hunger and you outgrow this attachment to thing. This is not Brahmana Jati, which is the mistake people do. This is the tragedy of language. Ki hum jati aur varna ko samajhte nahi hai. This is Vedic thought. Jati is what we see around the world with all its horrible things. Wo alag duniya hai. हम दोनों को मिक्स कर देते हैं. इट इज लाइक ट्राइंग टू यू नो यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ व्हाट्सएप. सॉरी, बेस्ट वे टू एक्सप्लेन इट.
वन मोर क्वेश्चन
एंड देन यू कैन डिसाइड हाउ
हाउ डज माइथोलॉजी एक्सप्लेन दिस जेरुसलम फिनोमेना, द थ्री डिफरेंट रिलीजन्स एमनेटिंग फ्रॉम सेम प्लेस.
यस, सो रिमेंबर ऑल थ्री रिलीजन्स, जुडाइज्म, क्रिश्चियनिटी एंड इस्लाम, बिलीव इन वन गॉड. दिस वन गॉड इन फॉर देम. Now the question is, if one God, they all refer to the God of Abraham. So technically, like I remember once I was in Jerusalem, but I was saying the Abrahamic faith. I kept using the word Abrahamic faith. And then they looked at me and said, you know, don't use it, we get very offended. I said, what, it's the same God, no? But they didn't like it. They said, no, we are Jewish people, we are not them. हम वो नहीं है. सो आई एम इन जेरूसलम, सो आई हैव टू बी वेरी केयरफुल बिकॉज एवरीबडी हैज अ गन. आई थॉट आई वॉज बींग टॉकिंग टू अ वेरी इंटेलेक्चुअल ऑडियंस विच इज नॉट लाइक यू नो तलवार लेके खड़े हैं, बट तलवार लेके खड़े थे. सो ऐसे ठीक है भैया, बिकॉज यू बिलीव वन गॉड ओनली एंड एवरीबडी एल्स हैज अ फॉल्स गॉड. सो जेरूसलम इज एन आइडिया बिकम्स अ फिजिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ अ साइकोलॉजिकल बिलीफ कि ओनली वन गॉड. And it is in Jerusalem, because Jerusalem is where it is, every religion's most important event happens in Jerusalem. So Jerusalem is where the Judaic religion established its first kingdom. So this is where David sat. This is where Solomon built the first temple. So that is important for Jewish people, as per their history. As Christian history is this, or near around this place, Christ was crucified. So that makes it important. According to the Islamic faith, this is the place from where the Prophet went to heaven. He had this huge journey where he traveled from Makkah to Jerusalem to heaven and was given the rules that we are supposed to follow. Tino bolte hi hamare liye important hai. So that idea is a very different idea from, let's say in India, you'll have you heard of the concept of Dakshin Kashi? You know how many Dakshin Kashis are there? At last count, there were about 2,000 Dakshin Kashis in India. Which means, ye bhi Kashi hai. Ye Bhagwan hai. And it is possible for that moment of time. This way of thinking is very different. So, you go to Ganga today and you do a puja and you say, Ganga jal chahiye, and then immediately you can see the bacteria. And you get nervous. So they will take you Bisleri bottle. They will put one drop of Ganga Jal in it as an inoculum. After that, they'll put a chlorine tablet and say, abhi sab puja kijiye, chal, sir. Which means I can shift metaphorically very rapidly. This is the one God's religion are uncomfortable with metaphor. They're comfortable with literal. Therefore, the best scientists also come from here. The highest number of Nobel Prize comes from the Jewish communities. One. Can't handle. If you read the Talmud is only a series of interpretations around one idea. They don't have multiple focus. Indian thought, this operating system has no central point. Although we use the word Vedas, it is not a correct understanding because that's a British understanding of India. If you really go to Tamil Nadu, it's really Alvar poetry. If you go to Srirangam and all that, it is first the Alvar poetry and then you will read the Rig Veda. So these ideas that the multifactoriality of this operating system, there is no central point. There are multiple central points. So you destroy one point, the other point will rise. Destroy this point, another point will rise. Is a very different way of looking. So it's the operating system where one way of looking forces a geography. This geographical linearity exists in the global fields. That's why there's so much violence. And we are unfortunately confusing these two operating systems. This operating system, this middle operating system, allows you to be a little more relaxed. But we are losing it because we are not understanding it. They all have the same operating system. They have the same operating system. And they are but there are three apps, which for us looks like the same app. For us, from this operating system, ye teen app kyun banaye? Go there, they'll get very upset. I have faced this a lot of times because in many of my writings, I write Judeo-Christian Islamic. I use in one line. It really offends people in the West. I'll never forget, once I wrote an email to someone, a very senior professor, and I said, you know, the Western religions, or I said, religions which originate in the West, I don't use the word Western, which originate, so you have to be, so he said, but Islam is not that, because I said, but sir, you are in Europe. For you, Islam is into your East. For me, it is to my West. Why is your direction more important than my direction? He apologized. He was a matured man. He apologized. He said that, I'm sorry. I'm used to this. I apologize for that. Then you realize you have a great man to talk to because you can really have a good conversation with him. If he had said that you are wrong, I would have said, bhaiya, aap se baat nahi karna hai.
Sir, my question is, what is the difference between mukti and moksha?
They mean the same thing. They're just fine-tuned. It's but like quantum physics.
You find mukti, but in some literature, moksha is given some other meaning.
No, no. See, moksha is a more Sanskritized term. Mukti is a less Sanskritized term. That's it. Nothing. There, technically, you can find one school, one sampradaya, they will make 35,000 differences. But that is that sampradaya. Mota moti, they come to the same basket. You know, so it's a fine-tuned technique. It's too much of, like, PhD level. So, chhod do.
What should be the goal of our life and... why we exist, means why I exist.
Excellent question. For that, you have to buy my books. Brahman bahut ho gaye, abhi thoda vanik bhi banna padega. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. Oh, lovely. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
We are giving you a book without being best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.